it to you because it is one that I know people have been asking. And as a matter of fact, a lady came to a couple weeks ago, wanted to know something about this. And so that is why we are going to be discussing what we discussed tonight. It's a question that's on a lot of people's minds. It's an event that are going around the world today. And so that's what we're going to be dealing with, the travel network of events. But first, I want to give you our in the kingdom of man. Listen, in Daniel chapter 4 and verse 25, I want you to keep this in mind so that you can put things in the proper perspective when it comes to understanding what's going to go on in the days ahead or years to come and so forth. Notice, in Daniel 4 25, Daniel makes this statement to King Nebuchadnezzar. And he says, he tells Nebuchadnezzar what's going to happen to him. And he says that he's going to eat grass like a cow. He's going to be out in the fields. The dew of heaven's going to be on him. His hair's going to grow like a wild beast and so forth. But this is what it says. He says that 7 times shall pass over thee till thou know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomsoever he will. In other words, God is in charge. You can think what you want to, Nebuchadnezzar. And say, you can think what you want to about the kingdom that you have built up and the glory of it. But God is in charge of kingdoms. God is the power behind all thrones, no matter who they are. In Jeremiah 12:17, Jeremiah says, God says to the voice of Jeremiah, to the word Jeremiah, but if they will not obey, I will utterly pluck up and destroy that nation, said the Lord. In Jeremiah 18:7, and what instant I shall speak concerning the nation and concerning the kingdom to pluck up and to pull down and to destroy it. So here's what you need to remember, friends, and that's this. That behind the scenes, there are powers that we don't see, but yet they are working because God is in charge in the kingdom of man. So whatever happened is happening in the world today. You can just know one thing for certain. You may not know if some knight over in the Far East is going to fire some ballistic missile. You may not know if some knight in the Middle East is going to fire off a nuclear weapon. You may not know if some knight in the United States is going to fire off a nuclear weapon. You know this, that God has his finger on the pulse of every nation, and he's in charge. Notice, in Psalm 75, verse 7, listen to what the psalmist says. But God is the judge. He put up that one and set up another. And again, in Psalm 83, in verse 18, that men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the Most High over all the earth. The power that is above all power, the King of kings and Lord of lords, is God. He's in charge. And so when you see what's going on today, you ought to say, well, I don't want to blame God in charge. See, I don't say, Babylon is painted, Baal is confounded, Merodach is broken in pieces, her idols are confounded, her images are broken in pieces. Somebody obviously is either unaware that we're on TV or unaware we're on TV. Declare him on the nation of itself standard. For God with the Lord shall come into a nation against her, which shall make her land desolate, and none shall dwell therein. Verse 4. In those days, that time said the Lord, the children of Israel shall come, they and the children of Judah together, going and weeping, they shall go and seek the Lord their God. So, all of this is simply saying that Babylon is going to be used as the instrument of destruction or punishment upon God's people and other nations. But when that nation, when Babylon, when its iniquity is full, when they are full of themselves, and they are sorry themselves. And that's exactly what happened. Israel was punished by Babylon, carried off into captivity for 70 years. Babylon was punished by the Medo-Persians. The Babylonian Empire fell to the Medo-Persians, the Persian Empire, and then the Persian Empire fell to the hands of Alexander the Great and the Greeks. And the Greek Empire fell ultimately to the hands of the Romans and so on. And so it is the case, friends, that God is using nations to carry out his will when they become so self-serving and self-indulgent that nation will fail. Now, I don't know what's going on in the world today, exactly what timeline we're on, but I know this. Because it's America is becoming a very self-serving country. And what will happen to the United States is the same thing that will happen to all nations prior to the United States and what happened to all nations after the United States when they become like the nations before them. When they become self-serving, they'll follow just like Babylon of old. And that's what Daniel was explaining. Daniel was explaining this when he was interpreting that in Daniel chapter 2. In chapter 2, Daniel tells a dream, interprets a dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. Daniel 2 and verse 31. He says, now, O King Solomon, among the great image, this great image, whose brightness and natural stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image had with a fine gold, his breath and all the silver, and plenty of gold, and grass, and blades of iron, his feet, part of iron, and part of flame. Thou sawest till a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet, that were iron and clay, and break them to pieces. Then, while the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, the gold, broke the pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, and no place was found for them, and the stone that smote the image became a great diamond that filled all the earth. Verse 36. This is the dream that we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the Lord God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom. God gave him a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field, the fowls of heaven, hath he given unto thy hand, and he hath made thee ruler over them all. Thou art this head of gold. And it's telling you, you are the head of gold. After this, verse 39, shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron, forthwith as iron, great in pieces, all that subdues all things. And as iron that breaketh all these, it shall break in pieces and pure bruise. And whereas not so, the thing that told the threat, and whereas not so, the thing that told the power of powder's clay, and the power of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, but there shall be in it the strength of iron, forthwith as thou. So, iron and wheat with iron and clay. And as the toe of the head of the feet will part iron and part clay, so the kingdom shall be part strong and part broken. Verse 43. And whereas thou said, iron and clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, what I'm telling you, friend, is these times are speculating. When we can go to God's Word, we can go for sure. The reason why they're speculating is because they're looking at the Bible and they're looking at it, trying to find certain events and take them into the Bible. But if you just go back to the Bible, it's all kind of there. You can understand how God is working. You may not know every specific detail, but they have to reveal those things to us. Things that are hidden. Those are God's gods. But the secret things belong to God, and the things that are revealed to us are for us. And that is what it is. And so, what I want you to realize is God is working in the human being. And this is how you can know what's going on. So, let's go to a chapter in the Bible that is probably the favorite, the most favoritist of these guys. And that's Revelation 13. Now, I've been asked questions about Revelation. That's what Revelation is not. And one thing I want you to realize, friend, is behind this. I realize we're standing around the middle of the book. But I want you to know this. The picture of Revelation. Revelation is a book of symbols. If you don't keep that in mind, friend, you'll miss it. You'll miss it. So don't start writing me emails and kind of questions with all this literal stuff when the very first verse says, and it is symbolic. Notice this. Revelation, chapter 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he signified it by his angel to his servant John. There are symbols signified in apocalyptic language. Friends, there are symbols in this book. Then you can take a speed tag, and if you start making them literal, you can have trouble. When you start trying to find a literal 144,000 and a literal dragon that's wrapped up in a literal chain that's come to a literal bottomless pit, and then you start looking for a literal 1,000-year reign, you can be in trouble. These are symbols. These are figures. They're numbers. They're figures. They're symbols. Then you have to understand that Dante. You'll miss the book of Revelation. So, let's go to Revelation 13. And let's see if we can make some application to the world today and see in this beast that's going to be revealed to us in this symbolic language of Revelation 13. Revelation 13, and I'm pretty sure most of you are familiar with this. You've been following Jack Bennett again. And some of the other guys, but Revelation 13 introduced two beasts. These are Satan's helpers. And what their job is to destroy God's people. Now, these beasts are really their servants, they're ministers for Satan. If you will notice in Revelation 13, God said, I stood upon the sand of the sea. A beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon ten horns, upon his ten horns, ten crowns, upon his horns, ten crowns, upon his head, the name of blasphemy. Now, let's figure out who this beast is. This first beast, comes from the sea. This is the sea of humanity. It's the sea of nations, the sea of people. Look. How God is talking in Revelation. Why don't you go back and listen to how he talks in those places? That's the key. See, God is not changing the rules. He's not really changing the vernacular of the speech that much when you can understand it. If you look, you can figure it out. If you want to know how God is talking in Revelation, go back and listen to how God is talking in other parts of the Bible. Look, in Psalm 65, notice this, verse 7, which stilleth the noise of the seas, the noise of the waves, and the tumult of the people. God is talking about people in the sense of their sea, and this beast comes up out of the sea Daniel saw what Daniel saw. And what John saw, they're the same beast. Serving seeing is we're seeing the devil